As we get ready to start the Malifonium concert, I think important to mention that, in memory certainly of Carl Saunders. And as you all know, Carl played in the Malifonium Orchestra, and we had many, many times to hear stories about that, kid him about it, so on and so forth. Carl, it's a great loss, certainly, and a great loss to us at the festival because, he is sorely, sorely missed because he was responsible for a lot of different things, more than just playing, more than just things. Carl was a guy that, we would get all kinds of advice from and information and so on and so forth. So we counted on Carl. And that goes back many, many years to the very beginning, early on. Carl, and I don't think there was one festival. I lost count at some point, but this is the 30-some-odd festival of its type, going back to 1991. And I don't think there was one that Carl missed. I mean, maybe there was, but I don't think so. I think in one form or another, he was in every single one of these. And we certainly, it's a great loss, and it's something that, obviously we didn't expect. And but I just wanted to, as we get ready to start the Malifonium concert, not to bring things down with that, but just to acknowledge Carl and just to, and thank him for, so many years of being here and for being so important to us. So in memory of Carl Saunders. The mid-1940s at the point where Stan Kenton started to, the Stan Kenton Orchestra sound really started to develop and come into play and really crystallize. And over the last few days, we've had a chance to see films and presentations and things that kind of talk about Kay Winding and certain people coming into the band. One of the important things that helped to establish the sound of the Kenton Orchestra as we think of it was the enlargement of the brass section. When first going to the five trumpets, and then eventually going to the five trombones. And again, providing the ability for the composers and for the arrangers, for the arrangers for the band, I should say, to be able to have the extra brass voices to write for, that would allow them to do, very loud, bombastic sounds, and yeah, to be able to utilize the brass in many, many different ways. And we came to think of that as the Stan Kenton, one of the key elements of the Stan Kenton sound. But then Stan, as you know, was always searching, always looking for something new, always looking for something different. So 10 brass wasn't enough. And as we start to get into the 1960s, there's the idea to add the four, what would become an instrument that he played a role in developing, the mellophonium. And so to add that section to the already 10-piece brass section, once again, gave this these different voices, which could create many different combinations and textures, whether it was Bill Holman or Lenny Niehaus or whoever might be writing for the orchestra. There were new possibilities, and it was something very different, very exciting, and something, again, that was unique to the Stan Kenton Orchestra and the Stan Kenton Orchestra sound. So we wanted to make sure during the festival that we acknowledge that part of the legacy, because it, again, another milestone of the Stan Kenton, of the creative world of Stan Kenton. So tonight, we're going to be able to have a chance to hear some of the mellophonium arrangements, or the arrangements that were written. Of course, the arrangers, some of the old chestnuts had to be updated to include the mellophonium section, and some had to, and then there were lots of new things that were written to feature that. Now again, we've had mellophoniums in the past. I should also say, another person we lost fairly recently was Joel Kay. And Joel Kay was here at so many of our concerts and festivals. And Joel was being the world's biggest Johnny Richards expert fan, Johnny Richards being his mentor, Joel was the world's biggest mellophonium fan as well. So Joel, bought the instruments himself And he would ship them out here, wanted to make sure that, you know, we had the actual Mellophoniums. Well, you know, there's, I won't go into it. There's a lot of reasons that, you know, that's a good thing, but there's also reasons that that can go south on you as well. So tonight, of course, again, it's the sound will be there, and it is the recognizable sound of that particular orchestra by using the French horns. The French horns, certainly, the horns, you know, it is relatively very close to where you will very much experience these arrangements the way that they were written. So it's a big, large orchestra, as you can see, and this is an organ the size of the orchestra that traveled around when that section was part of it. Now, Kim Richmond is one of the important Stan Kenton alumni that's here this weekend with us, both in a playing capacity and a leadership capacity. And tonight, it's the leadership capacity as he leads our new era in modern music, also known as the Mellophonium era. So here is the All-Star Orchestra and Kim Richmond.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. You're a wonderful audience. I've seen that in the last few days. It's really great to be here with you. Could you hear that? I know there's some a little bit of hard of hearing somewhere, but I think maybe you could feel it if you couldn't. Hear it, okay? That was Granada. That was composed by Bill Holman, or was arranged by Bill Holman. And we're going to kind of spread this out and feature different composers or arrangers, I should say, that, as Ken mentioned. And Bill Holman is one of them. We heard him last night with his band, which is marvelous. And then Lenny Niehaus is another. And Johnny Richards is a third one. We're going to hear from a couple of others too, Gene Roland and Dee Barton. So we're going to, I don't know which one, this is the next one, but one of the things we'd like to do is to feature some of our players, because they're playing these ensembles and man, takes it out of you, you know, just blasting away. But we also have some great soloists, and so I'm going to feature Jeff Bunnell on this, and this is called What's New. Jeff is one of those people that can play any part of the trumpet section. Usually you find players that are really good with a lead or the high notes, and find other players that are good with the solos, and he's got it all, both of them. It's Carl did too, Carl Sellner. So he subs a lot for Carl when he was here. So anyway, I need to tell you that I love the sound of the French horn. Yeah. That was Tony Little on the solo there. Well, I knew Joel Kay very well. We were friends, and friends and enemies in a way, because I loved the French horn. He did not like the French horn. He liked the mellophonium. And we had endless arguments on the bus, you know, when we were touring together. And he said, "Oh no, you're a French horn, no, I can try." I said, "You know what? They don't play in tune, those mellophones, you know." "But the French horn can't go higher like that," you know, and so forth. So he was really adamant about it. I never could sway him from that at all, you know. But anyway, that's a whole different story. We're going to do a piece now, arrangement by Lenny Niehaus. And he's also one of my favorites. And I got to meet him a few times, and he was just a great guy, and did great movie scores as well. You might not know that. And so this is called The Devil and the Deep Blue City.
Thank you.
I don't know all the names yet, you know, I'm just meeting some of these guys for the first time. At least I think it's the first time, I can't even remember. Now that's the first thing, that's the second thing that goes, you know, when you get older. I can't remember what the first thing is. Okay, we're gonna go to something by Johnny Richards now, one of my favorite arrangers. And just let me say that what's special about Stan's music, that we all love that, what he's put together. He put together so many eras. You know, the sign of a full-time, well, let's say a complete musician, is somebody that doesn't stay the same all the time. And we had I like to give the example of John Coltrane. John Coltrane was a marvelous saxophone player, as you know. And he has started out with Miles Davis, for what we know, and he played a certain way. And then he got into another thing, or he played as another way, you know, and everybody wished he'd go back to the old way, you know. But the same happens with Stan. A lot of people say, well, why can't they sound like it did before? Well, that's what we're doing here, of course. But I just loved that, and everything that he stood for, and I think it was a sense of, I think it was a sense of majesty. He had a sense of majesty in his music, no matter who's writing for him. Would you agree, Joanne? Yeah, okay. So, Johnny Richards was one of those people that really gave him that majesty. He was a wonderful writer, and he had an orchestral sound, an orchestral way of writing. Lenny Niehaus had a swinging thing. He did a lot of swing. And Bill Holman had both. You know, he could do all that. So, we're going to do a suite of tunes from West Side Story. That's the record that he did by Leonard Bernstein music. And I think we're gonna do them without talking between them, although we'll have time to get the music set and so forth. So this is, let's see, we're doing, have to read it. Something's Coming, and then Maria Cool. Is that right? And I Feel Pretty, and Somewhere. All arranged by Johnny Richards. Oh, on Cool, you know, they got to snap the fingers. So if you can snap your fingers, don't. Thank you.
so much.
There's more to come. Thank you very much. You're just a warm, wonderful audience. I'd like to take you everywhere I go.
We'd like you to. I got
a bigger car. We haven't mentioned Jeff Kay on the trumpet and solo. I wish I had 10, but I'd settle for 4 though. But I also write for some other groups, and one little lady came up to me and she said, "You know, when you write, don't write any high C's."
There's so many high C's in this book.
It's a lot of them. Yeah. Okay. We like to feature Ian again on the saxophone, and this is one of my favorite Bill Holman arrangements, and it's called Stairway to the Stars.
Thank you.
you know.
He gave me more than I expected. It's great. He's taught me everything he knows. Well, that's not the way it goes. You've noticed a variety of instruments in the saxophone section, notably the bass sax over here.
Woo!
Can you hold that up? That's asking a lot, because that sucker's heavy. Oh, yeah. Now, Joel Kay, who played the bass sax also, the baritone, and played just about every instrument. I tell you, he played some piccolo solos over on the side too, when he do that. But he took the bass sax everywhere he went when he was going to a gig or something like that. And he'd carry it on his back. He had a gig bag for it. They call it leather. Yeah, it's a gig bag that goes on over your shoulders and so forth like that. And he'd take that everywhere. I tell you, I didn't see how he did it. He was short. It was taller than he was, absolutely. So that's one thing that you could always recognize Joel when he was coming, because you could see his instrument first. Well, it's time that I told you who's in the group here now. I'm going to have to get out my sheet here so you can find it. I was telling you the other night, and you probably remember the other day, that I had this. Here we go. I had this in common with Benny Goodman. And I've played him many times on live on the stage, and he couldn't remember any names, you know. If you weren't here, I'll tell you the story there, because he'd come up with a name for everybody that was the same. You know, he'd call everybody Pops. Yeah. He'd say, and on tenor saxophone, we have Pops. And trumpet, that's Pops, you know. And somebody said he called his wife Pops one time. I don't believe that. Okay. Well, I'm going to just read my thing off here, because I can't. These people that I've known for years and years and years, and I stumble over their name. So, you know. And anyway, we have the saxophone section here. And you met Ian Roller right there. Stand up here. Casey, what's the last name? Passat? That's Casey. First time I met her, she's a terrific player. Glenn McCaskill. I better remember this name. Yeah, I tell you. Okay, Ann Patterson. This guy plays all of the saxes real well, but I put him on the bass sax, the baritone sax, and he's going to play in my orchestra tomorrow, and he'll also play bassoon then. So, you know, this is Brandon Wilkins. Okay, we move on to the trombones, and a familiar face that you've all seen, and he's been on the Kenton Band many, many years when he was there. That's Kenny Schroyer. Next one is Jakob Taffwood. Is that right? Close. Okay. And here we have, I can't read my own writing. What's the first name? Crisp.
Benny
Crisp. And Matt Evans. Right in the middle is Steve Johnson. I know him for a while. Our trumpet section is, let's see, get up here.
Awesome.
Yeah, I know. This is a bloodbath up there, they keep telling me that. Jeff Pennell, of course, on this. And you met Joel Kay over here. Jeff Kay. Michael Campagna is one of the lead players. Ryan, I can't remember it. DeWeese. Ryan DeWeese. And let's see, that's right. What's the first name?
Landon.
Landon Grigsby?
Grigsby.
Close enough. I'm just terrible at this, I'm sorry. Never make an announcer or not. And we have on the horns, we have Tony Dillon. Alyssa Hendrickson. Mark Ginsburg. And Lacey Wagner. The rhythm section, very essential for this. Jim Cox is on the piano. Peter, what's the last name, Peter?
Grimas.
Peter Grimas. And this last guy is somebody I cannot do without. He is just tremendous. He can read my mind. He knows what I want already. And that's Kevin Van den Nelson on the drums. He's a student of Peter Erskine, and right?
Yeah.
And he shows it. I tell you, he's just a wonderful drummer and propels us. I'm always relaxed when he's around because he'll always pick up pieces from me, you know. So that's it. Okay, we're going to do something by Gene Roland now. And this is called Dragon Wick. It's on a recording, so I'd never heard of it before. I looked at it on YouTube and found it. Thank you. is Gene Roland. He wrote a lot of arrangements and compositions like this one on the bus. You know, no piano there, just had it, you know. And how, somebody said, how do you compose and arrange on the bus that's traveling? He says, oh, I'm not doing any composing or arranging. I'm just copying what's in my mind. It's the best explanation I've heard. Dragon Week was the name of that song. A little different from Lenny Niehaus, right? Okay, we're going to go back to Bill Holman for a minute here. And he did, I think this was a commercial or something. It's Tico, the name of it. You remember anything about that? Tico?
Oh, I don't know.
Must be a bad story. Anyway, okay, this is Tico. Thank you. we're going to wind things up tonight, and it's about that hour, bewitching hour. And we were going to do another one, but it's the script on it, the notation is so crazy after all these years. We'll do it. But we're going to end up with a tune that's it's called Limehouse Blues. Anybody remember that?
Sure.
Yeah. You know, originally that was a Carter tune. And I mentioned that and want to play that in a jazz context, and some guys say, well, it's a Dixieland tune. Why would you play that? But I'll tell you, Bill Holman made it something else. And when I first heard it, after knowing the tune, my father taught it to me, I heard Bill's arrangement of it, and I said, that is hypnotist at its best. So, Limehouse Blues, and we thank you very much for your kind attention and everything. And we'll have the band stand up in a minute, so don't clap for them. They might need want more money, you know.